Hi dear friends, my name is Prashant. Welcome to my channel Crazy for DB, which is dedicated to the study of database related concepts and languages. My students have been insisting since long that I should create videos on some top questions which are asked in the interviews and technical tests as well as GATE. So here is the first installment of 10 questions in this video, and gradually some more videos will follow. Keep on visiting this site. This is the first and very fundamental question that is normally asked in the interviews, that is, what is relation in the relational database management system? The first term is relational, so this meaning is quite obvious. The answer has been given over here. The relation is in RDBMS is a normalized table. So any normalized table should be called as a relation. And what is a normalized table? Which shows common functional dependency of all of its non-key attributes on its primary key. So if we consider this as a table, then this is the primary key, the one that is painted red over here, and the remaining of the columns in this table are non-keys. And you will find that this is not called as a relation, for none of these attributes are fully dependent on the whole of the primary key. In this case, like name is dependent on student ID but not on subject, but subject is also the primary key, and so the subject has nothing to do with the name. So also about the phone call, which is dependent only on student ID, whereas fees only depends on subject, then teacher only depends on subject, and so we don't call this as a relation, but we call this as a simple table. But here we have two examples of relations. In this case, you can see that one student ID has been identified as the primary key in this table. The name is dependent on student ID, the phone number is also dependent on student ID, and so this is one relation. Then this is another table which is shown over here. Subject is the primary key. Fees is dependent on the subject, as well as teacher is also dependent on the subject, and so there is a functional dependency of all of its non-key attributes on this common primary key, and so such tables are called as relations. Now, as the term relation is defined with reference to a property called as dependency, the interviewer might directly ask you what the dependency is and what are the types of the dependency, and that too he might ask you to give the definition with some examples. When two related attributes A and B show that value of B can be uniquely determined by the value of A, then B is said to be having functional dependency on A. So for example, if in a bank we want to know the balance of a particular account, then if we tell him the balance, we cannot know the account number, but if we tell the account number, we can know the balance of that account number. So there are two attributes, the balance and the account number. So the balance can be determined uniquely by knowing the account number, and so we say that the balance has got the functional dependency on the account number. Other two types of dependencies are partial dependency and transitive dependency. Now they have been shown as an example over here, explained in the form of examples. In this case, there is one table here which is of students, a student ID, their name, and then phone number and date of birth and native, and you will find that once we identify this student ID as primary key, then name is uniquely identified by student ID, then phone is also uniquely identified by student ID, and date of birth is uniquely identified by student ID, and the native of the student is also identified uniquely by the student ID. And so this is actually the case of functional dependency. In this table, however, you see that the primary key is student ID and subject, whereas fees is only dependent on subject, and name is only dependent on student ID or phone is only dependent on student ID, that is part of primary key and not whole of primary key. And so this is the case of partial dependency. Here we have hypothecated that a student may take more than one subject in a tuition class which provides tuitions in different science subjects. Now in this third case, we have considered a table, we have considered a tuition class which provides a student only in one particular subject. And so in that case, the student ID becomes the primary key, and then you see that the name is dependent on student ID, native is dependent on student ID, but here the two columns subject and fees, the fees depends on the subject. And when fees depends on the subject, actually subject and fees both are non-keys, but fees, which is one non-key, depends on the subject, which is another non-key. This type of dependency is called as transitive dependency. Partial and transitive dependencies are undesirable in any table because they give rise to the anomalies and the redundancies, and so they are not considered to be good for the relational tables, and so they have to be eliminated through the process of normalization. Now the entire theory of relational database management system, that is RDBMS, was founded by Dr. E.F. Codd at IBM, and he formulated some 12 rules, and he defined the characteristics of a relational database management system in the form of those 12 rules, and these rules only came to be known as the Codd's rules, which are very popular in the academic circles. Those rules were defined around 1970, and it is not possible to list all the 12 rules over here, but certain important aspects have been listed over here which come from those 12 rules. The first one says that the data must be stored in the normalized tables called relations. Normalized tables, as we know, that only functional dependencies are shown in these tables and no other type of dependencies. So such tables are called as normalized tables, or they are called as relations. All the operations should be done using the non-procedural access. The languages developed for this non-procedural access is QB or SQL, and those two languages can only be used for accessing the relational database system. Then it must implement the concept of null, that is, where the value is not applicable or the value is not present, then don't substitute any value, but don't put any value at that. And so there is a void, no value is present, that is called as null. Then data integrity should be the job of database itself, that is, when the data is inserted or manipulated, the data must follow certain rules of validation, and that is what we call as data integrity. And it should not be implemented through the application, but it should be implemented through the by the database itself, so that it cannot be bypassed. You know, if it is put in the application, then if somebody has the access directly to the storage, then such a data integrity could be bypassed. So that possibility is eliminated by introducing this rule by E.F. Codd. Then data must be self-describing. What it means is that the metadata has to be stored again in the form of tables only, that is relational tables, and that should be called as data dictionary, and that should be there in every relational database management system. And this is one final important characteristic, that is provide the alternate virtual way of accessing the data. Virtual means that there should not be any object which actually stores or holds the data, such as view. This view is only in the form of definition, and when actually invoked, it in the background fetches the data from the source, which is table, but view in itself does not store any data, so it is an alternate virtual way of accessing the data. Now in this slide you can see the process of normalization itself has been defined. So the question here is, what is normalization and what are the goals of normalization and what are 1NF, 2NF and 3NF? Normalization has been defined here as a systematic process of eliminating data redundancy and avoiding operational anomalies by ensuring functional dependency in the table. So when we perform any operations like insert, update, delete or select, then there may be certain anomalies experienced in those operations. To eliminate those anomalies in the operations and ensuring that there is no unnecessary repetition of the fact, that is what exactly the data redundancy means. So such a process we call as the normalization. So summarily drawn from this definition itself, the goals of normalization are ensuring atomicity in the columns, that is every column must able to hold only one single value or one single fact. That is what we call it as the atomicity of the columns. Then ideally eliminate the data redundancy, that is no unnecessary repetition of the facts should be there. Eliminate the anomalies, that is insert, update and deletion anomalies are there when we create a normal table and not the relations. So those anomalies have to be removed. That is an important goal of the normalization. And then ensure functional dependency. Actually, once the functional dependency is ensured in all of the non-key attributes in any table, then automatically the above three goals are achieved. Then we have defined here the first NF, 2NF and 3NF. First NF is called as first normal form, and it is applied to ensure the column atomicity. And then second NF, that is second normal form, is applied to eliminate the partial dependency from the tables. And the third normal form, that is 3NF, is applied to eliminate the transitive dependency so that no one non-key attribute depend on another non-key attributes in any of the tables. So once that is achieved, then the set of relations is said to be in the third normal form. There are couple of some more normal forms like BCNF, fourth normal form, fifth normal form, etc. But normally, practically only third normal form is achieved and no normalization is done beyond the third normal form in the practical environment. Now here is the answer for if an interviewer asks about the explanation of some of the terms used in the definitions of normalization. So what is data redundancy and what are anomalies and what is decomposition, etc. So you can see that here this is the redundancy. As you can see that 105 the PHP subject has got the fees 1200, then again there is a subject PHP which is taken by 102 and the fees is 1200, and so both of these rows actually showing the same fact, that is PHP costs 1200. In the same way here 102 is taking two subject, one is Oracle and the other is PHP, and his phone number is getting repeated, and so the fact is getting repeated. But here see that this 1234 phone number is of 105 and 101 as well. This is not termed as redundancy because these two are different facts. In this case, the fact is 101 is having the phone number 1234, whereas this fact is 105 is having the phone number 1234. And so the fact is totally different. And so though the data value is repeated, there is no redundancy. And the deletion anomaly means if I delete such row, then I am actually losing the reference to the subject C and its fees 900, whereas this subject should exist even without the student. As in this case, you see the insertion anomaly is there. I am not able to record this Visual Basic and its fees because there is no student currently opting for this subject. Update anomaly basically comes from the redundancy because if there is unnecessary repetition of the facts like this, then we are required to perform the update multiple times, and external to the database we require to remember where to update and for how many times to update. Then this table has been decomposed, means it has been broken down into parts, and this table has been decomposed into three parts, and now these three parts are actually called as relations, where you can see that all the anomalies have been removed. I can very easily remove the student's row of 101 without hurting the subject C, which costs 900. I can very well, even without any student, I can enter VB cost 1800 as shown over here, and if at all I want to update the fees of PHP, I can do it only at once over here. No repetition of PHP cost 1200, you can see in this set of tables. Similarly, the phone number of 102-56718 has been recorded only for once over here. And so we have now explained the redundancy, the anomalies, and what the decomposition is. Now here is the basis for the relational theory, that is what is the difference between relational algebra and the relational calculus. Actually speaking, both are formal query languages for relational model, and the basis for the SQL language. Relational algebra, however, is procedural, telling us the sequence of operations to get the result. So there are seven to eight operations, as you can see, that is the selection, projection, then Cartesian product, join, union, etc. So there are 7 to 8 such operations, and when we are supposed to perform the processing on the data, certain operations, certain combination of these operations is required to be performed in certain sequence, and so when we specify that sequence of those operations, then that is relational algebra, whereas relational calculus is non-procedural and is declarative, and it only is there to tell the data to be retrieved. So here we just specify a condition, we don't tell the process of how to filter the data or how to get the data and what operations are required to be performed and in what sequence. We only tell the final results, and following those results the system is supposed to fetch the data for us. The relational algebra basically is the set of internal operations, whereas on the face of it we actually face the relational calculus. Here relational algebra defines how to obtain the results, that is basically the summary of this definition itself. The relational calculus that defines what information the result must contain, and is divided into two types. Tuple relational calculus, that is rows to show as per the condition, and then domain relational calculus, that is a list of attributes to be selected. So you have the choice in the relational calculus to either show the rows desired by the user, or to show only such columns which are desired by the user. And so that is the difference between the relational algebra and the relational calculus. Now this question is about the structure of, logical structure of the database. They might ask you what is a table space and what is a system table space. Now in this case, one should not get confused with the term table and table space. Actually, as shown here, the table gets stored in the table space, but it is not just the table, but there are a couple of other things also get stored, like indexes are also shown getting stored in the table space. So what actually the table space is? The table space is a logical storage structure, and it is defined as a group of one or more data files, and the data files can physically reside on the different physical drives. So there may be a data file DF1, then DF2 and DF3, and all of these three files together might make one table space, say TBS1, and these data files DF1, DF2 and DF3 may physically reside on drive 1 and drive 2 and drive 3, and in this way the table space can be formed. The concept of table space is that when we create any table, actually table in general term called as a segment. So also index is a segment, then cluster is a segment, then rollback segments are there, or the temporary segments are there. So there are main five types of segments. So a segment can span over the multiple data files of the same table space. That is what exactly you want to say. So a table is not just confined to one particular data file, neither is index or cluster or rollback segment or temporary segment. So none of the segments is confined to only one particular data file, but it can span over the multiple data files of the same table space, so that in the multi-user environment the readability is high, because the data gets divided over multiple drives, and that is an important advantage of having the concept of table space. Now, implementation of null is such an important aspect of the RDBMS that EF code was required to frame one rule totally dedicated to the concept of null. So here comes the question which is related to it, about how to handle nulls in the SQL. So what is the difference between NVL, NVL2 and coalesce functions? Actually speaking, all the three functions are used to handle the null values in the SQL. They have totally three different formats, as we have seen here, we are seeing here. NVL, that NVL function is used like NVL with two arguments, V, R, where V is the first argument and R is the second argument. It returns V if V itself is not null, or will return R, that is the suggested value, if V is null. Then in case of NVL2, there are three arguments, V, R1 and R2, returns R1 if V is not null. So V is tested for null, and if V itself is having some value and is not null, then the returned value will be R1, and if V is null, then the returned value will be R2. Whereas coalesce is not bounded by any number of arguments. There can be many arguments here, like V1, V2, V3 and Vn, etc. And you see that it returns the first not null value. That is, if V1 is not null, then V1 will be returned, but if V1 is null, then V2, if not null, is then V2 is returned, and if V1 and V2 both are null but V3 is not null, then V3 is returned. So in this way it will return the first not null value through the coalesce function. So these three functions are very important from the point of view of handling the null values in the SQL, as you can see in this slide. Now you see, actually the SQL statement is made up of certain clauses, and there are certain rules of syntax to be followed while arranging those clauses in the SQL statement. Here this question is based on the syntax of the basic syntax of the SQL statement. It wants you to find out if there is any mistake in this statement given here. The statement you want to find out the mistake in is select star from EMP, order by cell descending, where DPTM equals to 30. Now actually the mistake in this select statement is that the order by clause has to be the last clause in the select statement, because the rules of syntax says that it has to be the last clause, and so the correct form of the statement will be select star from EMP, and then you have to say where DPTNO equals to 30, and then you have to say order by cell descending. The properties of the order by clause, okay, have been enumerated here. You can see the properties of order by. It has to be used at the end of the select statement. That is the first and the most important property of order by. So no clause can be there after the order by. then it cannot be used in a subquery or nested query. Order by cannot be used in a subquery. If it order by has been specified on a column which is nullable, that is can contain the null values, then those null values are treated at higher end. Though nulls are not comparable, but order by does not ignore the nulls either. The nulls are put at the higher end of the order, and the default order is ascending, as has been said over here. Now there are several databases which are coming in the market based on the concept of NoSQL, and this is very obvious that a question might be asked in the interview: what is the difference between SQL and NoSQL? The primary difference between SQL based databases and NoSQL database is that the former one is relational and the latter is non-relational. SQL databases are RDBMSs, whereas NoSQL databases basically are based on the concept of storing the data in the form of documents. Here certain more differences have been made out in the form of the comparison table. So here are the properties of SQL databases. Here are the properties of NoSQL databases. Remember that they are not exhaustive list of the properties of both the databases. We have taken just a few of them. SQL databases basically based on table structure has to be defined first, so they are schema based. We have to use a create table command to actually create a table with well specified names of the columns and then the data types and their widths and precisions, etc. Whereas in case of NoSQL databases, no document structure has to be defined before creating the document. The document automatically comes into being as you insert the first data over there, and so it is supposed to be schema less, whereas SQL databases are supposed to be schema based. In the second point, data is stored in the form of rows because there is a table. Here in NoSQL database, actually the data is stored in the form of documents in something equivalent to the table called as collections, and the document itself is not in the form of row, but it is in the form of key value pairs being stored. Then the third point is relational data is stored in separate normalized tables, hence the join is required. Whereas in case of NoSQL databases, we have the related documents which can be nested, and hence no join is required. Rather, NoSQL databases were created for eliminating the requirement of joining the data, because that is one very important bottleneck in accessing the data in the relational database management system when the data volume increases. Then this important property of the SQL databases is that there is a built-in transaction support with ACID compliance. ACID stands for atomicity, consistency, isolation and durability. Whereas in NoSQL databases, not so well transaction support and the ACID properties are not shown in these databases. They are not ACID compliant. So these are the some of the differences between the SQL and NoSQL. Now here is a word of caution that I would like to give. That is, this video is about question and answers and is only suitable for last minute preparations. Remember that they do not in any way explain the concepts in detail, and so the visitors are advised to visit the detailed lesson on these subjects for better understanding, because in the examinations or in the tests or even in the interviews, you should actually show off your understanding of the concept rather than just giving the answer. The links to various videos are given in the description box below. You can open the description box and get the links to those different videos from where these concepts have been explained. Moreover, if you have any problem or query, please include it in the comments as a comment below for to be answered in the next video, so that they will form the basis for creating the next videos, and I will include those questions and doubts to be answered in the in some videos to come. So guys, here we have seen the answers of some basic questions. Before I take your leave, just to remind that subscribe to the channel and also click on the bell icon, so that you will continue to receive notifications about the updates on this channel. Thanks for watching. Bye for now, to meet the next time over some new topic. So take your leave. Bye bye.